Hi everyone, it's Plastic EP from Melbourne, Australia. Let me tell you, it doesn't get better than this. How are you today, Kathy?
Fantastic. How about you?
Really great. We're going to have a fantastic show. Now introduce our fantastic guests to the world.
Okay. Well, it's my pleasure to introduce Don Kleiman, and he's with Bobby Helms, some exclusive catalog, and Ace Duran, who's the executive chairman of and president and co-founder of Dream No More Studios. So it's my pleasure to introduce.
That's amazing. Now, guys, we're going to have a great show. And as I said, the world's there. It's your oyster. And just go for the questions, Kathy.
All right. Well, John Kleiman, this is exciting. I mean, can you give us a little history about Bobby Helms and how you came to know him?
Well, first of all, it's nice to be here. I appreciate being on the program. I met Bobby back in 1987. I was doing a film production at that time and looking for some music to put in the film. And I made a contact. I wanted to use his song, My Special Angel. And I made contact with the publishers and the people that had the license rights for the song. And it was very expensive. It was a low budget movie, still several hundred thousand dollars, because we were shooting on 35 millimeter, not like the video they now shoot on. And I couldn't afford that. I ended up getting a lot of publicity for the film, and it did reasonably well. Had theatrical release and VHS release. Bobby was doing a performance or concert at a venue close to Indianapolis. So right after we finished the film, I went to see him and said, "Hi, Bobby. I wished I could have gotten in touch with you, and maybe you could have pulled some strings and made My Special Angel a song I could use in the film." He said, "Well, I wish you'd come to me or contacted me, because I own 60 or 65 masters, and My Special Angel is one of them." And he said, "I could have given you a heck of a deal." And I said, "Well, I wish I'd known that." but anyhow, that's how I met Bobby Helms. And about 2 weeks after talking with him at this concert that he had, he called me and he asked me, he said, "If you can make a film," he said, "I think you can do about anything. I need a manager. Would you be my manager?" And so I spoke with him and we did an agreement, and I managed Bobby Helms until his death in 1997. And he became a very close friend.
What was the year? When did you meet him?
Around? I met him in 1987 and then managed him to 1997. He died June 19th, 1997.
Now, Ace, I got to ask you, Ace Duran, what a fantastic name that is. Tell me what's happening in your world.
Well, I run a little boutique studio called Dream No More, and it all started in the back of a laptop I had dreaming about holograms. And I went on this journey in 2008 to find out where the technology was, found out that there wasn't any sophisticated technology that was usually using the technology of real holograms, which is lasers, right? Lasers and mirrors. But I found a company in London called Musion, which was using this really fantastic hardware pepper ghost foil trick to bring the most realistic pepper ghost images alive. And so it looked like a hologram. And I thought, I wonder where they're using this beyond this stage in London. And they said, "You know what, we're not really using it other than just projecting models, runway models, fashion models, and having them turn and disappear and look really cool on stage." And I said, "You know, I think if you use a little bit of Hollywood magic, we could do something on a grand scale, like a Disney type of production." And so 2010 came, and I thought, "You know what would be really cool? To see the Beatles back on stage together in their younger selves." And I thought, "You know what? I'm going to take a swing at it and see if I can make this happen." And I partnered with a gentleman who is basically in the family of Ringo Starr. And we pitched the idea to Ringo's manager, Bruce Dracal. And Bruce thought it was the most ridiculous thing ever because there was really no proof of concept. So 2011, I went on this journey knocking on doors. I went to Elvis Presley's estate and said, "Hey, listen, we have this hardware stuff. Let's bring Elvis back." And everybody thought I was kind of crazy. It wasn't until late 2011 that I made a phone call to the Tupac Shakur estate and talked directly to Afeni Shakur's mother and pitched the idea. And she said, you know, Ace, if you could make this happen, I could dream no more. And it just happened. Dr. Dre came in, funded the project, Coachella 2012, Tupac appears, and everybody's blown away. The very next day is when I got the call from the grandson of Bruce Gracow and said, you know what? He gets it now. Let's do something. And so our next big venture was to create the first ever Ringo Starr hologram. And that really kind of just got us on the railroad tracks going 1,000 miles per hour, showing that, you know, this could be a really cool medium for technology. And, you know, 12 years later, here we are.
I got to tell you, that's an amazing story. What you're telling me, you're a pioneer. And as I said, when you're knocking on doors and people don't know if you're real or a joke, there you go. Technology's not a joke, and you were on it while other people were thinking about it. But to actually experience that on stage, for example, if you saw Elvis come back and sing with one of his relatives or his daughter, I'm just saying it's mind-blowing because people have not experienced it. And as soon as you mention the word Beatles, I've got to say, I've interviewed a lot of close people to the Beatles, and it's like an amazing journey. And for you to even figure out, let's have the young Beatles up there. I mean, to me, you just got to tell me a little bit more about the technology. Did you use it for Elvis?
So what we did is we built the software to create the avatar of Elvis Presley. We never used it on a commercial scale. So once we had the approval, which I soon gained the approval, to build an Elvis avatar, we were able to show that in private meetings to kind of just get people to get interested and invest in the technology. But we never did anything on a grand stage like we did with Tupac. I think the next time you got to see something that incredible was 2014 with Michael Jackson at the Grammys. And I wasn't a part of that project, but what you got to see at that point was how big this presentation can get and elaborate if you kind of invest a lot of money into, you know, the experience. So John Texter and the Michael Jackson estate put that show on. And I don't know if you guys remember it, but it was fantastic.
So John, oh, you're working with Wolf Entertainment, Helmut Wolf?
Yes. Ace is a partner and he's my manager. And he's handling the licensing of the 61 songs in the music catalog of Bobby Helms that I have. And Bobby signed all those over to me about 2 years prior to his death because he had emphysema and he knew his health wasn't going to get any better. And like I said, we're very close friends. And Ace is going to bring Bobby Helms back in the form of a hologram. And Jingle Bell Rock is one of the best known Christmas songs ever. And I don't know anyone else that is more appropriate to have a hologram of than Bobby. And that way people who are in next generations will still know what a young Bobby Helms looked like. And they can see that he was young in 1957 when he made that hit and wrote it.
Bushels of fun. Now the jingle hop has begun. Jingle bell, jingle bell, jingle bell rock. Jingle bells chime and jingle bell time. Dancing and prancing in Jingle Bell Square. In the frosty air. What a bright time. It's the right time to rock the night away. Go gliding in the one horse sleigh. Giddy up, jingle horse, pick up your feet. Jingle around the clock. Mix and a mingle in the jingling feet. That's the jingle bell rock.
Jingle bell, jingle bell, jingle.
feet jingle around the clock. Mix and a mingle in the jingling feet. That's the jingle bell. That's the jingle bell. That's the jingle bell rock.
Yeah, so, you know, John and I, you know, our mission obviously is to keep the legacy of Bobby Helms alive. And we know it comes alive every Christmas because you hear that song hundreds and hundreds of times during the holiday season. But, you know, the magical thing that's missing is Bobby Helms himself. And so instead of just hearing that iconic, beloved Christmas song, now we're going to be able to see Bobby sing it the way it was meant to be, right? On a stage or in the middle of a fantastic event, or a mall, or a commercial, or perhaps even a movie. So that's our mission, and that's what we're going to do. And we have a lot of great support at this moment, and we're getting really close.
That's amazing, because I can see this technology, as I said. Imagine a Beatles show where you're actually showing a concert of the Beatles, and they just illuminate and come out of nowhere, and you're experiencing it. So the hologram makes the experience with the music. Like, in other words, you got all these components that elevate the show. For example, you remember in the, I think it was the 80s when disco was big, or the 70s when they did that Beatlemania concert, right? Mm-hmm. And that was in New York and everyone experienced the Beatles. Do you remember that? That was huge.
I remember it.
See, you know, they brought back the Beatles. So what I'm trying to say is, this sounds to me like you need to talk to Apple and explain to them that you could do something like that. Because I think, you know, the Beatles are still number one in the world, believe me. And as I said, with the Get Back documentary that came back, it showed how big that was. And with the Buzz movie, right, of Elvis is as huge. We know that because it's just happened now within the last year.
Yeah. Absolutely. And, you know, the Beatles and Apple do know about it. Paul, you know, he loves technology. He's kind of dabbled in it. I think what they're waiting for is just the right time, the right moment. And I think we're getting close to that. And, you know, it's all about experience, right? So you go see a concert, you want the greatest experience possible. And if you have the greatest artist to bring that experience to life, then you just have kind of a double-edged sword in a most magical way. So, you know, when I think about presentation, it's not really about just putting a hologram on stage and having the audience lock in and listen to a song. It's about what you're bringing, the Disney factor, right?
Yeah.
You need to immerse story involved into the presentation in order for someone to buy into it. And I think that's where the kind of the niche of where people will buy into it. If you're not just trying to sell tickets and make money, but you're bringing them an experience that they would never have ever been able to see. And why not do it with icons like the Beatles, Elvis, Bobby Helms?
I agree totally. Now, John, I just want to ask you, doing what you're doing with music, getting people involved and things like that, how many major artists have you either represented or spoken to in your career?
A lot, mostly members of the Grand Ole Opry, because Bobby was a crossover artist into pop from country. Kenny Rogers was a close friend of mine. I have managed Sandy Allen, who was the world's tallest living woman in the Guinness Book of Records, traveled with her, and that took a lot of extra care in handling Sandy. Did that for at least 10 years, probably. I've worked with the amazing Kreskin as a road manager.
That's big.
That was on The Tonight Show with Johnny Carson and did a lot of television shows, and Kreskin's still a close friend. Like I said, a lot of artists I've met. Johnny Cash, Jeannie C. Riley, a lot of the people who back in the day were legends and had hits with their music. Bobby had 6 gold records, and so that's not too bad for a country boy from Southern Indiana, you know. And his first big break was when he went on the Ed Sullivan Show and he sang My Special Angel on there. And they actually had him back twice within a month, which is one of the very few times that that he did that. And that's when he first met Buddy Holly and did the show with Buddy Holly and Jackie Wilson and a lot of actors and other vocalists, other singers.
Let's go on to talk about your exclusive Elvis Bobby Helm story. I mean, yeah.
Well, this is involving the fact that we did a television series called Bobby Helms and Friends, and we never planned the show out. We would go in the studio, and even though it was only 22 minutes long, plus you add the commercials into it, it took about 2 hours to complete a show because we had guest artists on. They had to set up in the studio and everything. And Bobby and I had a lot of time to talk. And I asked Bobby one time, I said, what song you want to sing? And he said, well, he said, I'd like to do an Elvis song. And I said, well, that's good because you haven't done one on any of the shows so far. I said, which one are you going to do? He said, I'll have to think about it a little bit. I said, did you ever meet Elvis or know him? He said, well, I said, I've talked with him on the phone a couple of times. He said, and I was disappointed because management was setting up an appearance in Las Vegas with Bobby and Elvis Presley. And they were both going to be in the same theater, but they were going to split. Elvis would do part of the show, and then Bobby would come on, and he would do his part of the show, but they weren't going to sing together. And I said, well, how did that go? He said, never happened. I said, why didn't it happen? He said, management could decide who would have top billing on the marquee outside. And so it didn't happen because of probably record labels got into it. Bobby was with Decca, and Elvis, I think, was with RCA. Or Colonel Parker didn't like it. And I have since heard that Colonel Parker was really tough to get along with. So I shared this story with Helmut Wolf. And I know Helmut from the fact that Elaine Elizabeth Presley is doing one of the duets with Bobby for Jingle Bell Rock. And we have about 19 artists set up, and John Swan or Swanee is one of them. We have Marcelito Pomoy, who was on America's Got Talent. He's done a Jingle Bell Rock duet with Bobby. And basically, it's a version of the song, a master version of the song, that they sing part of the song, and then Bobby's part is edited in, and it sounds like a smooth song, and you think they're in the same studio singing Jingle Bell Rock together. And it's the first time it's ever been done, and it's being done in foreign languages. We're going to have it done in French and Spanish and Brazilian and lots of languages. In fact, I don't have a complete list of them, but Helmut Wolf has put together a great team for that.
Now, so I just want to ask you, what are you currently promoting, or what projects have you got coming up, or what would you like to tell all the fans in the world out there?
Thank you. We created an all virtual band called ZR3 in partnership with Oliver Tree, who's a rising artist, and with probably the number one producer in the world, Louis Bell, who has over 10 top number one hits on the past few years. And this is a virtual alien band. It's the first ever all virtual band signed under Atlantic Records. So we're committed to 19 master songs. That album is going to debut at the beginning of next year. And we're going to produce 3 music videos for these holographic aliens to be the next biggest boy band. So that's a very exciting project that we're working on right now. And, second to that, our focus is creating this Bobby Helms experience and getting them out there and getting them back on the road.
Yeah, that's an amazing project. I like the aliens. So keep us in mind when that's ready to roll. We'll do another show and help promote that. Because now you're talking about something that's like totally different. Like imagine an alien Beatles.
Exactly. Exactly.
Now, John, I got to ask you now with what you're doing now and all the projects and everything you're going, just update everybody on what's actually happening now.
My focus has been on doing the duets with Bobby, and the release date on all of those is August the 14th. Some of the artists have recorded My Special Angel. We have Skip Martin, who was the lead vocalist and trumpet player with Kool and the Gang and Daz Band, and he's done it, both songs. Marcelito Pomoy recorded both songs for us. And my main focus is to get Bobby Helms back on the road with Ace in time for Christmas. And you never know, maybe the alien will sing Jingle Bell Rock with Bobby as well. I'd like that to happen.
Sounds unbelievable to me in a time when it's 2023 and we're going on to new technology.
Well, Helmut was telling me that Bobby Helms, the song Jingle Bell Rock, has been in the top three in the last 3 years of all genres of music. Is that correct? Someone can answer, Don?
Yes, you can take that. It is.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's undeniable, a classic that will continue forever. And I think, you know, the progress that we're working on, especially, you know, his exclusive wine brand and collaborating with, you know, other artists. Bobby Helms is coming back, guys. And you know what? He could create new music and could sing an Elvis song with the technology that we have at our disposal. So we're really excited about all the AI possibilities that we can use with Bobby Helms' likeness. And we're going to go to the full extent and make a lot of magic.
Sounds fantastic out there. Now, I want to thank everybody for being on the show. You guys are VIPs, believe me. Everything I've heard today in this interview has blown my mind. Now, Kathy, I want to thank you again for organizing John and Ace. And let me say, let's move from 2023 now to all these exciting projects. And we wish you all the success in the world because you guys are on a track and I can tell that where you're going and what you're doing is like groundbreaking. So for that, I take my hat off to both of you. And I thank you both for being on the show.
Thank you,
Pastor. Thank you very much.
We appreciate it.